Hosanna to the Son of David!
Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord!
Behold, your King comes to you, O Zion, meek and lowly, sitting upon an ass. Ride on in the cause of truth and for the sake of justice. Your throne is the throne of God. It endures forever. And the scepter of your kingdom is a righteous scepter. You have loved righteousness and hated evil. Therefore God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your fellows.
Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today we come together to bring this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that, united with him in his sufferings, we may share in his risen life. God our Saviour, whose Son Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem as Messiah to suffer and to die, let these palms be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Friends, hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
So friends, let us go forth praising Jesus, our Messiah.
Thank you. so let us pray for a closer union with Christ in his suffering and in his glory. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do sit down for the first New Testament reading.
A reading from the letter to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Please sit. Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying,
We found this man perverting our nation,
forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is a Messiah, a king. Then Pilate asked him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
He answered,
You say so.
Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds,
I find no basis for an accusation against this man.
But they were insistent and said,
He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even to this place.
When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod with his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them,
You brought me this man as one who is perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him.
Then they all shouted out together,
Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us!
This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting,
Crucify him!
A third time he said to them,
Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him.
But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished.
As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said,
Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed. Then they will begin to say to the mountains, Fall on us, and to the hills, Cover us. For they do this when the wood is green. What will happen when it is dry?
Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
And then they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying,
"He saved others, let him save himself. He is the Messiah of God, his chosen one."
The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying,
"If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself."
There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying,
"Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us."
But the other rebuked him, saying,
"Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong."
Then he said,
"Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
He replied,
"Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said,
"Certainly, this man was innocent."
And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things.
This is the Passion of the Lord.
And so, in the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
For forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For grace to seek out those habits of sin which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christian people, that through the suffering of disunity there may grow a rich union in Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who make laws, interpret them, and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who still make Jerusalem a battleground, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in the darkness and agony of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who, weighed down with hardship, failure, or sorrow, feel that God is far from them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
that we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Together we say, Holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us.
Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
So we wave that sign of peace to one another around the nave.
We have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For as the time of his passion and resurrection draws near, the whole world is called to acknowledge his hidden majesty. The power of the life-giving cross reveals the judgment that has come upon the world and the triumph of Christ crucified. He is the victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain, who lives forever, our advocate in heaven to plead our cause, exalting us there to join with angels and archangels forever praising you and singing.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God.
praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people and gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We say together, Faithful God, may we who share his banquet glory in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, our salvation, life and hope, who reigns as Lord now and forever. Amen. Just a few notices before I send you on your way this week. Firstly, if you're a member of the 50 Club and you pay your annual £36 rather than a £3 per month standing order, that renewal is now due. So if you could get that £36 to Nick Heckford, either via him directly or via the office or via internet banking, however you do it, and just let him know. And if you don't know what the 50 Club is and you want to know more about it, there's an item in the weekly news. Do have a look. And if you want to join us in that, again, get in touch with Nick and he will sort that out for you. Just a little reminder that the porch is open on Wednesdays and Sundays until 4:30 for you to drop off food for the food bank, which I'm very grateful to Jez and Elaine that they run and collect and ferry all the food down to where it needs to get to. A couple of times recently, we've had some enthusiastic, conscientious people find the door open and lock it, which means people haven't been able to drop their food off. I think I have discovered it's actually our contractors. So it does help if I tell them what's happening. So as they've left the site, they've walked past the door and thought, oh, they've left the church open and locked it. I think we're good now. But if you come across the door being shut on a Wednesday or a Sunday afternoon before 4:30, could you just let Lyndon know? I say Lyndon because, of course, after next week, I won't be around to pick it up. But just help us keep an eye on it to check that we have sorted it out. I don't think there are any other pixies locking the doors, but you never know. Do have a look at our weekly news for the Holy Week services this week. There's something on in church every day of the week, and actually they're all important stages in the journey. Holy Week makes sense when you can visit as many of those as you can and makes the joy on Easter Day even more special. So do join us for as many of those as you can, and again, they're in the weekly news that has been sent out to you. And just finally, we had our APCM on Thursday. Quite a small attendance, I think, but then I'm kind of not surprised. We haven't sort of really got back to necessarily coming full complement to things yet. In fact, I know there's 71 of us, 72, no, plus gluten-free, 73 of us in this service, and that's our biggest so far since the pandemic began. So I wasn't surprised our numbers were a bit low at the APCM. But it was a good APCM. It's always just the joy of the number of ministries that there are in this church. And at the APCM, you thank all those quite public offices, as is part of the ritual to do, the church wardens, the pastoral assistants, the PCC. There's a long list of people that we thank. In this rather more public setting, where there's twice as many of us sitting in the room, plus a goodly number at home, I do want to thank some others, some of those, some of them quiet, not all, but largely unseen ministries that we just rely on that happen. And I know I will miss people out, but I want to thank our cleaners who come in. I want to thank our servers, especially our new ones who have just stepped up into this role. All three of these have only been servers for 2 or 3 weeks. Our food bank collections, our children's society boxes, our leprosy mission, our flower ladies, the people who serve tea and coffee. There are myriad ministries that go on that keep this church functioning. But one that isn't quiet, but is unseen because you never see him, is of course Jim, who sits up here hidden behind a pillar. And week in, week out, sometimes several times a week, if there's funerals and weddings and things, plays for us. And we just come to accept that heavenly music descending, don't we? Because we don't get to see Jim. But for Jim and for all those ministries I've just said, and for any who are sitting there whose quieter ministry perhaps I haven't mentioned, please know how valuable it is. And can we just thank them in the usual way too? Thank you for all you do. This church could not function if it wasn't for all these amazing people stepping into roles, and I am really grateful. So as you have blessed us by just who you are as a congregation, so now I'm going to pray God's blessing upon you, that you may take and be that blessing yourselves out in the world. Let's stand if you're able for this blessing, and then remain standing for our final hymn. May the Father, who so loved the world that he gave his only Son, bring you by faith to his eternal life. Amen. May Christ, who accepted the cup of sacrifice in obedience to the Father's will, keep you steadfast as you walk with him the way of the cross. Amen. May the Spirit, who strengthens us to suffer with Christ, that we may share his glory, set your minds on life and peace. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Holy Week to love and serve the Lord.